Now, recently, Kenya recently approved laws to allow for production and importation of genetically modified crops. It's due to stifled food production in the country. Drought's been recurring with increased frequency and severity in Kenya, which scientists say is a result of climate change. To tell us more about the options is Dr. Florence Wambugu, CEO of Africa Harvest. Dr. Wambugu, good afternoon.
Good afternoon to you.
All right. Tell us about the recently promulgated Biosafety Act, and it should be moving Kenya into a new era of food production. How does it revolutionize things?
Yeah, it's a landmark to Kenyan Kenyan the area of science and technology. The fact that the country has did pass the biosafety bill, and that the statutes to operationalize it are also being done, and they are in the process of being gazetted. Of course, that will really put Kenya in the same category as South Africa, Burkina Faso, Nigeria, and Egypt, the country that are now in the process of being able literally to commercialize the GM crops to support food security. And it means that we can actually import, we can produce, we can export, because Kenya government want to be forward-looking. We have a vision called Vision 2030, which is very forward-looking.
All right, let's talk about the safety element. I'm underscoring here safety in biosafety. How does this new system of GM production ensure that seeds are resistant to the changing climatic conditions, the changing component of the soil, and that ultimately the crop is safe?
GM crops, like any crops, needs to have the soil fertility, fertilizer or manure, or they need soil fertility issue just like any other crop, indeed, for them to be productive. And some of the technologies available are going towards having drought-tolerant crops. But overall, the crops are there mainly focusing on productivity based on increasing productivity by fighting insects, pests, and those that take quite considerable amount of the harvest. In terms of safety, there are regulations which are government regulated in other countries that really address the issues of food and environmental safety. And many of these regulatory bodies, whether it's in Kenya or other countries, are really not private. They are done by the government to ensure that they are effective.
Dr. Wambugu, I mean, you'll remember, if you cast your eye back to 2003, 2004, there was huge controversy in Africa, particularly countries like Zimbabwe and Zambia, questioning the authenticity and the sanity of importing GM foods in the process of food aid into Africa. Basically, they were raising questions around the nutritional value of GM foods. And ultimately, when you're talking about seeds, the extent to which GM seeds would contaminate existing.
That issue was resolved. It was resolved by actually grinding or milling the grains so that the grains that was leaving South Africa to go to Zambia or Malawi cannot be planted without people knowing and germinate. So there's a way allowed that, and I think it had been happening. In other countries, they have found other ways of dealing with that. In terms of the issues of safety, certainly, as I said, these are issues addressed by the government, not individual scientists or individual institutions. GM technologies are actually government regulated. But really, you look what's happening in Africa and overall, we have 1 billion people more to feed in the world. Africa alone, we're about 1 billion now, and a quarter of African are not able to have enough food. We are producing less. My own country, Kenya alone, the Horn of Africa, my own country, 3 million people are starving right now. Mm-hmm. And we have the Horn of Africa, serious hungers, issue of hunger and famine. And I don't want to say that GM technology is the solution, but I want to say that it's part of the solution, because if we save the 20% that goes to insects and pests, that's a lot. If you look, Kenya is now importing 1 million metric tons of grain. if 20% of that was actually not being imported because we can produce locally by using GM technology, right, that's a substantial amount of money. You look at the countries that are, you have using GM technology, like South Africa, the only countries that are food secure and actually exporting grain, right, to other countries.
Okay, Dr. Wambugu, let's talk about broader issues, because one of the biggest problems we have in Africa is large-scale commercial farming. Many of our farmers are subsistence, small-scale farmers, they're women as well. How does GM become a game changer? Because absolutely, it may change the seed component, it may make it quicker and easier to produce foods, but it doesn't address the structural problems in rural economies. The fact that we need to be exporting a lot more volumes, producing a lot more, and we need to be organized farmers.
Well, I think the solution, the way I think the GMCs are penetrated, whether the ones, because we really should be talking about what has happened now. We are talking about 15 million farmers globally. About 14 million of these are small-scale farmers in China, right now in South Africa, in Burkina Faso. So it's not something hypothetical, it's happening. And we need to see what's happening in the countries where GM crops are being used, because as we are talking, over 1 billion hectares have been planted. And the technology is growing at 10% every year. It's not really, we do have this going on. And the system used, the same system we use for hybrid seeds. And for example, my country has been using hybrid seeds for a long time. And the principle here is coexistence. The people who have seen the value for hybrid seeds, they're able to buy and use the hybrid seeds. You can also keep your own seeds. You can also use organic. So that should be, it should be give farmer all the options that they need. The options of having GM, which are maybe tolerant to the insects and pests, maybe they are nutritionally better. Give the people option to use organic farming, give people option to use traditional farming, let people have hybrids. And with these options, then you find the niche which is really best suited for your own ecological area, and you're able to produce more. We must also look at the issue of poverty in terms of diversification. Because Africa is a very diverse continent, you know. The green revolution of Asia was achieved by two crops, wheat and rice. Africa, we need to look at more diverse crops. We need to look at beyond maize, we need to look at banana, sorghum, cassava, sweet potatoes, yams, many other crops, traditional crops, right, that now we call orphan crops. And that also will provide us with food security.
Okay, Dr. Wambugu, very briefly, how cost-effective is the GM alternative? Because in Ethiopia, for instance, they're dabbling with issues like seed incubation, and it just seems like to import the technology to utilize it is very, very expensive.
I think every technology that comes in, whether it's cell phone technology, has to be used where it is best suited. I don't think there's one jacket fits it all. Again, as I said, even hybrid seed are not used by everybody. But there are really opportunities, because even all the countries, including here, we have large-scale farmers in Kitare. In South Africa, you have large-scale farmers, large-scale, small-scale farmers. You find what is most suitable, and the country must focus on the food security by having these big, what you call, bread baskets, so that we are not importing the grain. So there is room. I think there's room, there is space for GM technology. However, as I said, it's not just the technology. We have to invest in fertilizer. We have to invest in water management, dam the water during the rainfall season so you're not all going to the sea. Make sure that is a total integrated approach. That's the way we are going to fight hunger and poverty. The GM does have its own place, but it's not GM as a silver bullet. It's GM as part of an integrated strategy.
All right, thanks so much for your time, Dr. Florence Wambugu, CEO of Africa Harvest. We're taking a short break on the program. When we come back, we're talking about Nigeria's new cabinet, particularly the big name, Ngozi Okonjo-Iweala.